Johnny Walk, every mountain, Johnny Walk, every ocean, Johnny Walk, every canyon, every inch of earth and sky, Johnny Walk, every morning, Johnny Walk, every midnight, Johnny Walk, every moment, every second of my life.
Good morning, CSL Parker. Woohoo! I'm Ann Grove. I'm a practitioner here at CSL Parker, and I'm your host for today's service. Also, not to use the word service twice in a row, I'll work on that. Assisting is practitioner Dr. Vern Martin, and he will be assisting on the platform. Okay. At Center for Spiritual Living Parker, we all honor all paths to the divine, all paths to God, which makes many of us feel like we've finally found our home. I hope you feel like that too. And I just want to say, welcome home. We've been waiting for you. We provide CSL Parker. Mission, providing spiritual tools for personal and community transformation. That includes this Sunday gathering, offering classes and workshops, and being of service to the greater community. One way we serve the greater community, whether it be your friends or someone across the world, is that every Sunday service is put up on YouTube. You're welcome to view it again if get straight that thing that you're like, huh? If something moved you, please do share it. You can open a conversation with somebody, whatever. But that's one of the things that we do to service outside of ourselves. Okay, well, I heard in the rumor mill that there were some brand new things happening. And I don't know if that's true, but I know that Joe Albers is going to set me straight about what the rumor mill said was true and what the rumor mill exaggerated.
And if you believe that, I've got some swamp land down in Florida I'd like to sell you guys. So, I don't know if I'm going to set anybody straight here. But Dr. Vern is going to come up here and do an announcement as well. So I'm going to go skip a few things to get through this quickly. And so, beautiful fall day out there today. And there is a 20-minute guided meditation at the beginning before the service every Sunday at 9:30 with our practitioners. And if you have any ecclesiastical issues to address them to Felina Harrington, raise your hand, Felina. Or Shirley. Shirley, raise your hand. She's a long ways away. She's in the Philippines. Kenny has set up a thing that's awesome for us. She, the local benefactor for November, December is a group called the Crisis Center in Littleton. And she has set this up. And we have donations we can leave back there on that table. I see some back there now already. That's everything from toilet paper to paper towels. But no clothing, okay? They don't need any clothing, but pillows, sheets, bath towels, etc., they could definitely use. And then if you want to adopt a family, there is a form back there for you to fill out, and you can adopt a family. So it's pretty cool stuff. So thank you, Kenny, for all that work and everybody else that participated in that. And then our Benevolence Tithing Fund for October is, through January 2023 is going to the American Red Cross Hurricane Center for Hurricane Ian and Nicole in Cape Coral, Florida. So that comes from the donations that you make that we tithe to them on a national basis, I guess. So, all right, so we have that. And then Dr. Vern, beginning the new year, has a new class, and it's called Living Untethered by Michael Singer, who we've studied before. And it's a next exploration in consciousness starting January 4th or 5th, 2023. We all want to feel more joy, happiness, and deeper meaning in our lives. But are we looking in all the wrong places? When our sense of wholeness depends on things or people outside ourselves, a coveted job, a new house, a lavish vacation, or even a new relationship, sooner or later, we're bound to feel unsatisfied. That's why we must look inside for our real freedom, love, and inspiration. But how do you embark on that journey? You sign up for this class, all right? And I'm guaranteeing it, all right? Money back. If you don't like it, come see Joe. Did I just say that? Ooh, this is scary. All right, I'll donate it to the funds. So anyway, so we have that coming up here soon, and it's just a great thing, and there's a book that goes with it as well. And now I want to also mention that on the 18th of December, we have a potluck here after the service, and it's a dual thing. It's part a holiday celebration, and the other part is saying goodbye to Alicia, our illustrious director for all of our music over the years. So that's coming up on the 18th, so plan to stick around after that. Now I would like to invite Dr. Vern up here. He would like to say something, if I can get all my papers off of here, about the next pledge drive.
Thank you, Joe. Good morning, everyone. You can leave now. I'm going to talk about money. Anyway, we started our pledge drive a couple of weeks ago, and we started it off with a bang. The first weekend, we raised almost $50,000 in pledges. So I want to thank you and compliment you so much. Last year, I did a cost analysis. You know, people think church is there and God just provides everything, but the truth is, it takes money. And in doing some cost with that, I determined that it cost us about $80 a seat per Sunday to run a service. And the larger the community, the less that would cost per seat. So I want to just say what a generous, committed group of people we have here at CSO Parker. And we have a pledge drive going on. There should be a white card or green card. If you did not have a chance to pledge, would you raise your hand? And Jennifer Drybread will bring you a pledge card. Jennifer, we got some hands up here. You can contribute weekly, monthly, annually, quarterly. I know I give through Zelle, and I don't even feel the pain because it's taken out of my bank account in every month. We have one over here, Jennifer. And it's quite painless. But anyway, I just want to instill with you a great sense of gratitude that we all have for your generosity and your support. So thank you, thank you, thank you. Now, what's next, Ann?
Are you guys awake? I missed it. We raised over $50,000 in the first week of our pledge drive. Is that okay? Yes! Yes! We are living large. And thank you, Spirit. Anyone here for the very first time? I know there are a couple people here, and there may be some other people. Want to welcome you personally. If you did not receive a visitor packet coming in, Jennifer will make sure that you get one. In that visitor packet, you get an introduction to us and our philosophy. There's also a card for you to fill out. If you would be so kind as to fill that out, it will allow you us to place you on our weekly email list. We will not spam you weekly, but you'll know what's going on, who's speaking, whatever else is happening. Where am I? Oh, I know where I am. Okay. So, if we could take a minute, stand up or don't stand up. You can get on the floor and greet one another. My definition of greeting is a hug, an elbow bump, a smile, eye contact, whatever it is. Let's just celebrate knowing each other.
And we are so blessed to have this amazing CSL Parker band led by Tony. All right, let's have our reading next. And the first thing I'm going to read from is A Course in Miracles Teacher's Manual. And I did the Course in Miracles, the entire course, or it did me, I should say, some years ago, but it was one of the most profound experiences of my life. And I got finished with the course, and then I went to the teacher's edition, and then it really got me. And what I want to share first this morning is about judgment, because in our theme for today, it's just really important to feel involved and part of something. And I found that it is my judgments that separate me from the crowd. So here's what it says in A Course in Miracles. It is necessary for the teacher of God to realize not that he should not judge, but that he cannot. In giving up judgment, he's merely giving up what he did not have. He merely has become more honest. God's Son is guiltless, and sin does not exist. The aim of our curriculum, the Course in Miracles, is the recognition that judgment in the usual sense is impossible. And so the last sentence really got me, and it said, therefore, lay judgment down, not with regret, but with a sigh of relief. Now you are free of a burden so great that you could merely stagger and fall down beneath it. Then the next reading is from a gentleman called Paul Farini in a book called The Laws of Love. And one of the 10 laws he describes is the spiritual law of equality. And he starts off the chapter by this quote, every brother or sister is your equal. Love him or her as you love yourself. Will you now join me in prayer? Divine Spirit, with a heart filled with gratitude this morning, a heart that is full and open, open heart, we open to the beauty and the glory of the presence of God within. We open to that inner kingdom of heaven that lies within each of us. And I know for each person here and those who are watching at home that we truly, truly belong, that each of us is an equal brother or sister, one with the other. And as we greet and meet, let's look into the eyes and the hearts of each person and see God. See goodness. See a guilt-free expression. See and experience the light of God in that individual, in all individuals. Let's truly lay down our judgment and allow ourselves the gift of seeing the purity of all life. I bless each of you. I bless your innocence. I bless the Christ within, knowing that we truly, truly know and experience the divine in each other. So let's welcome one another with open arms and open hearts. And now, will you join me in sealing this prayer by declaring with me, and so it is.
Sinner, he's heard all mankind, save his
I can feel the love vibrating in here. Oh. It is now my great pleasure to introduce our guest speaker today, Reverend David Howard. He is an ordained minister who most recently served as senior minister at Unity Spiritual Center in Denver. Prior to relocating to Denver in 2014, he served as the spiritual leader at Unity in Arlington, Texas, where my dad is from. He had that position since 2008. He achieved his licensed Unity teacher credential in 2014 and was ordained in 2017. David was co-founder of the Center for Life Enrichment, a New Thought spiritual center in Dallas, where he served as minister from 2001 to 2006. David began his journey with New Thought at Unity Church of Dallas in 1995. He then studied religious science for many years with Reverend Dr. Kay Hunter and later Reverend Petra Wells. Before entering the ministry, David enjoyed a 27-year career in commercial insurance industry in Dallas as an underwriter, broker, and executive, a career he has recently resumed. He has recorded 2 albums, and I notice he has a box of CDs under his chair, but I'm not sure what he's going to do with those. One is In This Moment, Praise from the Well of... Nope, wrong. That was his book. His albums are Spark and Coming Home. His book, This Moment, Prayers from the Well of Awareness, collection of inspirational prayers and meditations written during the time he served the Center for Enrichment. He also has a blog, Rev David Howard at blogspot.com. Let me know if you know what to do with that. And Jeanette, was there anything you wanted to add? Jeanette says Reverend David is a living, breathing open heart. And now please help me in joining in extending a warm welcome to our guest, Reverend David Howard.
Thank you. Thank you for that. I do have some CDs that, and I'm happy to give them to you. I know CDs are kind of old technology. So I'm happy for you to take one if you'd like to take one with you when you leave today. So thank you for inviting me back to be with you guys today. It's been such a pleasure. Last time I was here, I felt the love and the energy and excitement of this community. And so it's nice to step back in and feel your love once again. So thank you for being here and for letting me be here as well. And so today I want to begin with a question. Not necessarily a question I want you to answer out loud, but something I want you to consider for a moment. And you may think it's a very simple question. But my question is, why are you here? Not in the grand scheme of things, but why are you here? Why are you here in this place, right here, right now, sitting in this chair? Why did you come here? You know, I saw some snacks on the table. Maybe you come here to have snacks with your friends. Maybe you come here because of the beautiful music. Maybe you come here just to be inspired by that. Maybe you come here because you like being with friends. And maybe you come here because you get to explore your own spiritual beliefs and learn and grow. And so I'm guessing that all of those may be true. You know, wouldn't it be easier sometimes for us just to stay at home in our PJs, have our coffee, watch a service on television? A lot of people do that. Nothing wrong with that. But sometimes it would be simple and easy rather than getting up and getting dressed and putting on your makeup and driving here. Some of you drove a long way to be here. So did I drive quite a ways to be here as well this morning. But wouldn't it be easier sometimes just to do that? But you come here. And you come here for a reason. And I'm guessing that even whatever your answer might be, for that question, I'm guessing there is something really deep within you, some need that is being met by being here, by being in spiritual community. And that is that universal human need to belong. To belong to something greater than ourselves. Brené Brown, in her book, The Gifts of Imperfection, said the deep sense of love and belonging is an irreducible need of all women, men, and children. We are biologically, cognitively, physically, and spiritually wired to love and to be loved and to belong. We need to belong because belonging does give us that sense of freedom, doesn't it? Don't you come in here and you, like when you walk in the door and you walk and people greet you and they hug you and you walk into this space that is created. I mean, it's a school. But you create a space, a resonant field when you walk in here, when you come together. And you create this resonant field of energy, of love, that invites, that draws people in. And you draw people into this community, into this energy field, where you feel nurtured, I'm guessing, and loved. And you feel free. Free to experience your own spirituality, free to question. Free to explore. You don't have somebody asking you, well, is religious science the same as Christian science? Or is it really Christian? Anybody ever ask you that when you say, well, I'm religious science or I'm CSL? I mean, growing up in the South, that's all I ever heard. Was it Christian? Is Unity Christian?
Yeah.
But you get to explore that for yourself. And as she says in that quote, to belong is primal for us as human beings. It's a primal need for us. It's part of our evolutionary process. Because at one point in our process, in our evolution, if we didn't belong, we were very vulnerable. If you weren't part of a tribe, you weren't part of a group, you were isolated. And you were vulnerable to attack. You were prey to other tribes or to animals or whatever. And so we learned the importance of being part of a community, of a tribe. You know, we see it in nature. If you watch those nature shows where you see the lions hunting and they find a way to isolate one animal, so that animal becomes more vulnerable to attack. And so when we're not part of a tribe, it's like this tribe, this community, helps us to feel safe and protected, meets other needs for us, right? And it's really important for us to feel that and to be a part of that because it nurtures us physically, spiritually, emotionally, and mentally. I was reading this week that the Centers for Disease Control has put out a study that says that during COVID, when we were isolated, that deaths from overdose of opioids increased 30%. 30%. Now, I know there were some other things involved in that, but this idea that when we're isolated, when we're alone, when we're not part of something, we feel that. We feel the pain of that. We feel the fear of that. I'm sure I'm walking outside of the view of the camera, so I should just stay here. Okay. I like to walk around. So when we're isolated, when we're alone, it's fearful. It's lonely. It can be scary. Have you ever been somewhere in a group or some community where you didn't feel like you belong? Anybody ever feel that? What did that feel like for you? It was kind of, I felt that for sure. And when we feel that kind of fear, And that kind of pain of loneliness and isolation, sometimes we want to medicate that. Studies show that the leading cause of addiction is really isolation and loneliness. That people don't feel a part of something bigger than themselves, and it's scary and it's painful. And so we want to numb that pain. And it's really important for us to feel like we belong. And also, sometimes when we feel like we don't belong, we will try to fit in. Anybody ever done that? When you're in a group of peers or some group where you really want to belong, but something says you don't, and you develop these strategies for trying to fit in. And what happens when we do that? That we deny ourselves. We hide our light. We don't allow that true self to shine forth. And what happens then? We suffer from that. We suffer from that. And I know because I've experienced that firsthand. Growing up as a sensitive gay boy in the South, in Georgia, in a patriarchal culture, in a very Christian culture. I was a little boy who would rather play with dolls than with trucks. I was a little boy who would rather play with an easy bake oven. I think I even remember asking for an easy bake oven for Christmas one year, and my father was appalled. But guess what I got instead of an easy bake oven? I remember this distinctly. I got a BB gun. And so I learned how to, I even went hunting with my father one time, which was traumatic. Once, only once. And I shot this rabbit, and I cried all the way home because I killed this rabbit. And so I was a child who did not fit in to this culture. And yet I tried to fit in to this culture. And as a result of that, I pushed away aspects of myself. I'm guessing I'm not alone in that. That very often we do that. And even when I was about 13 or 14, I thought I found a place where I could belong. Now, you may say, well, how in the world would you ever think that? Because it was in a Baptist church. But I was about 13 or 14, and I became a part of this youth group. And I really thought I belonged there, and I did in some ways belong there until I really began to awaken and discover my sexuality. And then at about the age of 18, I was asked to leave the church. You don't belong here. Painful experience. So I was not in a church for a very long time. And then I ventured back into a church in my late 20s. And it was a Methodist church. And then I was there for quite a while. And once again, the whole thing came up again. So it's painful. When you think you belong, when you want to belong, when you really want so much to belong, and you're told you do not belong. And there is that part of us that we relegate those aspects of ourselves, we deny aspects of ourselves, and that becomes our shadow, really. It's still a part of us. And as Brené Brown also says in her book, which I think is so important, is that belonging is an innate human desire to be part of something bigger than us. Because this yearning is so primal, we often try to acquire it by fitting in and by seeking approval, which are not only hollow substitutes for belonging, but often barriers to it. Because true belonging only happens when we present our authentic, imperfect selves to the world. Our sense of belonging can never be greater than our level of self-acceptance. Our sense of belonging can never be greater than our level of self-acceptance. And that's why it is so important for us on our journey, on our spiritual journey, on our life journey, to recognize those parts of ourselves that we have relegated to the shadows. It could be, for me, it could be my creative self, that part of me that just wanted to be joyous and creative and expansive and live the joy of life itself when I was a kid, whether that was wearing my mother's shoes or playing with an Easy Bake Oven or playing with dolls or fixing somebody's hair or whatever that might have been. I don't know what it would have been for you. But however that was expressing, you, each one of us is a perfect, wonderful, unique expression of God, of spirit, of source. And each of us has within us that true light and spark and life. And we're here to express and to experience and to be all that we can imagine that life to be. And when we hide that, who suffers? Well, first of all, we suffer. But in hiding our light, the world suffers. The world suffers. I think the Course in Miracles says something about that we're withholding God from God when we don't allow ourselves to live our full light. You're the light of the world. Let your light so shine that that life might be glorified. And so, when I first walked into a Unity church in 1995, I heard, "You are as God created you, perfect and whole and complete." Sound familiar?
Yes.
Perfect and whole and complete. And you are loved just the way you are. So if no one has ever told you that, you are perfect and whole and complete. And you are loved just the way you are. Just because you are. And it was there that I began to feel like I could breathe. I could exhale. I could belong to something greater than myself. And I wasn't there for too long before I went to religious science. And I found a community there that embraced me. Every aspect of me. I didn't have to hide part of me. I didn't have to relegate part of me to the shadow. But that's a lifetime of work. It's not about getting rid of the shadow. It's about embracing that aspect of ourselves and shining the light on that aspect of ourselves, bringing the light to what we would rather not identify with. And so I say all of that today to you as I started out, why are you here? Why are you here? I'm guessing you are here because you belong here. You feel like you belong. It meets a very primal need for you to belong, to be a part. And I'm going to ask that you be aware of that, but also as a spiritual community, to be very mindful, and I know you are, but to be very mindful of that, the fact that you are co-creating this space, this energy field, as a spiritual community. And how important it is for somebody who walks through those doors for the very first time to feel like they belong. Because I believe when we have that primal need met, and only when we have that primal need met, can we truly belong to ourselves and begin that process of growing and expanding and exploring a deeper level of who we are. We have to be accepted, included, to belong to something bigger than ourselves, feel safe enough to share, to grow, to question. Do you remember when you first became aware of new thought? And can you hold that memory for yourself? Whoa, what is this? There are people who think like I do. You know? There are like-minded and like-hearted people out there that I want to be a part of. Didn't you feel that way? And so when people come into this space, I just invite you to be conscious of that. That they too are looking for a place to belong. They're looking for a place where their light can be reignited and expressed and experienced and shared. You know, very often in unity, we use this affirmation, I behold the Christ in you. I behold the Christ you are. I behold the Christ in you. I want you to go home and look in the mirror today and say, I behold the Christ in you. I behold the light in you. You are the light of the world. Whatever it is that works for you, I want you to own that. I want you to affirm that. And I want you, when somebody walks through that door next week, to have that focus in your mind. I behold the Christ in you. You belong here. And I want you to know that this is a safe place for you to be exactly who you are. You don't have to hide. You don't have to hide your light. Doesn't it feel good to be in a place where you don't have to hide your light? So keep that in your minds as you're beginning. I know you're in a transition place right now. I understand that. And also, this transition space is something ends, something begins. Things are always moving. And so as you open yourselves up to that. And as I say that, I also want to say to you that just as we as individuals have a shadow, so do organizations. So do communities. And so I invite you to be aware of that as well. Not to deny it, not to try to push it away, not to think it's awful, not to think you're bad, not to think you're wrong, not to think there's something really intrinsically wrong with you or with the organization or with whatever it is. But to look at it. To shine the light on whatever that is, because it's only as you embrace it that you're really going to be in a place of welcoming and opening arms to other people. And I know that's your intention. You said it in the prayer. Open arms, open minds, open hearts. So I behold the Christ in you. As individuals, I behold the Christ in you as a community. And I trust and I know that you do the same for each other and for everyone who walks into this space. So I want you to turn right now to your neighbor and say to him or her, I behold the Christ in you. And I behold the Christ in you. And thank you for allowing me to be here and share with you this morning. Blessings to you.
Wow. This is our time of offering. Know that everything that is willingly given, whether it's time, talent, or offerings, comes back to you many times over in many different ways. All that you are, all that you give, deepens your connection with the divine source of infinite prosperity. So if you would hold your gift in your hand, hold your hand on your heart if you give electronically, and repeat after me, I give this gift for you. I give this gift for me. Knowing that as I give, so shall I receive. And so it is. And oh, he's good. That's why we let him sit up front. Along with your gift and your love that you put in that basket, would you please include your pledge card? If you're not able to do that, you can fill it out, fold it in half, and leave it in the back. And I promise you, nobody's going to look at it. We're just going to give it to our treasurer. So, if I could ask Jennifer, our usher for today, to come forward and get us started.
I am open to receive.
All right. I know that we are open to receive all God's blessings, and that the love and blessings and tithes that we put in here today and that we put in every week, go forth, do the work of CSL Parker, support everyone, that our love is boundless, and these gifts are a token of that boundless love. And so it is. So I want to thank everybody who had any part at all in today's service, especially Reverend David Howard. Wow, I haven't been so... Woo! I kind of lost track of myself. He grabbed me and held on to me through that whole thing. So thank you so much. We have so many helping hands. We have our hospitality team, which is led by Kenny Johnson, practitioner over here. They're the ones who set up the tables, get the coffee hot, get the water cold, set up everything. And oh, by the way, they're the ones who greet you when you come in the door as well. So it's a wonderful, terrific team. You could always join that team on an ad hoc basis. If you're here and you're happy, see what you can do to help. If you're here and you're not happy, especially see what you can do to help. Also, thank you to Colleen, who is our ad hoc goodie provider. It feels impossible to replace her because she does such an awesome job. And if we love her, we need to spell her once in a while. So again, she comes, she brings. If you have something at home, if you're bored on Saturday night, bake some brownies, bring them. I'll eat them. What the heck? So, okay, where am I? Thank you to Jeanette Bennis, our camera operator today. Thank you to Jennifer Drybread for being our usher today. Thank you for Kathleen, who for being with our children today, and here they come. So most especially, as always, thank you to our CSL Parker band, led today by the amazing Tony Sajowski. We have a special song of going forth today, one that's really close to my heart. I hope it's close to yours. I think it really represents what we're all about here at CSL Parker. If you're called to do so, feel free to join hands with the person next to you, to join elbows, to make eye contact. This song is about the love we share. And before we do that, I would like to ask Reverend David to once again join us and do our benediction.
So as we take a moment, take a breath, once again, breathe in the energy of this space, the love, the belonging that you feel here. Breathe into the awareness of that light of God that you are right here and right now, perfect, whole, and complete, just as you are. And as you leave this place today, feel the joy of that, the expansiveness of that, and go out into the world today sharing that. Everyone you meet, behold the Christ in each and every one. And know that as you do, you uplift the world, you change the consciousness of humanity, and you change the trajectory of this human race. You are important. You do make a difference. So go forth in the light of God, and so it is. Amen.
So it is.
Buzz in the system here. Sorry, drive this nuts.